Hi, my name's Andrew Wheeler, and the following tape is of Sudbury Candidates, 1997. Just going to start off with a lecture for the guest speaker for the weekend, who's going to talk about some of the inadequacies in the Maine militia, and then we're going to have a few interviews and demonstrations from some of the enactors, and just a basic overall highlight of what's going on. And that's going to end with an interview with Dr. Howe, for which I apologize for the rather poor lighting and some of the sound quality during the tape. I would encourage everybody to attend it next year. It's a good time, and as you're going to see from this tape, the people, the enactors, are very well educated, informed, and are willing to talk. So we'll see you there.
Was an ineffectual military organization for protecting Maine from the British. That's point one. Point two, ultimately the defense of Maine rested in the hands of the Eastern Indians rather than the militia. And my third point that I would emphasize, that the one person who was most instrumental in persuading Maine's Indians to at least sympathize with the American cause was a Nova Scotian, a refugee from Nova Scotia named John Allen, Colonel John Allen. So those are the three points that I would have you carry with you as you leave. So first I'd like to talk a while with you about the militia and some of its characteristics. The militia in Maine, of course, was simply an extension of the system that had evolved in Massachusetts, of which, of course, Maine was then a part. All adult white males between the ages of 16 and 65 were enrolled in the militia. The point I would emphasize here is, besides the anarchy, the anarchic situation, is that the militia so far had little military function, but its chief function seemed to lie in the area of politics, harassing loyalists, stifling dissent, and radicalizing the local population, with Falmouth as a key illustration, but far from the only one. In short, what the militia under Thompson did in Falmouth was to create a crisis. The British retaliated, and British retaliation leading to the burning of Falmouth then polarized the population that remained there and turned those who were wavering from one side or the other into either Tories who left or flaming Whigs who remained. So that the role of the militia seemed to be more political at this point than military. As a military force, the militia proved to be of marginal value at best. Even after the Massachusetts Provincial Congress, that is the revolutionary government in Massachusetts, reorganized the militia, its military value was in doubt. The Massachusetts government appointed for each county a brigadier general, and then the effectiveness of the militia system appears most clearly, perhaps, in the famous or perhaps infamous Penobscot campaign of 1779, when the British seized Castine. You probably know, on the eastern side of Penobscot Bay, this in 1779, and constructed a fort there. Massachusetts retaliated by launching a 40-vessel armada and trying to raise 1,500 troops from the three main counties as a force to expel the enemy. And again, you may know that this turned into a disaster of the first magnitude for the Americans. The troops were hard to find, and the army lacked 500 men from the very outset. Most towns did not send detachments from their own militia, but rather hired men to go. Now, here's something worth thinking about. The militiamen in these towns, in the three counties of Maine, those who were at least reasonably trained and equipped, stayed at home. Those who were drafted or recruited were those that the towns would spare most readily. The poor, indeed the destitute, the drifters, the laborers. These were the ones who were sent off as the personnel of this army. The troops were described by one officer, and this was after the defeat, and that's rather significant in itself, but the troops were described by one officer as too old, too young, or too stupid to make good soldiers. The only criteria for a recruit was that he be able to, and again I quote, carry a gun, walk a mile without crutches, or only compass mentis sufficient to keep themselves out of fire and water. End quote. They were wretchedly equipped and were worse disciplined and poorly led. After a particularly humiliating encounter with the enemy, the more frequently the militia responded to alarms, the less time they were able to spend raising crops for their families and themselves. And we come up with a sort of interesting paradox. War and farming were both warm weather activities and were mutually incompatible. And so the more the militia met alarms of British attacks upon the coast, the less were the militia able to be back home supplying their own families. The militia in Machias, as an example, and Machias was the easternmost, most vulnerable outpost against the British, of course, in Nova Scotia. The militia in Machias refused to come in to build fortifications. You would think that if anyone would be aware of the precariousness of their existence, those in Machias would. But they argued in refusing to build fortifications that their place was at home supporting their families. The forts were built, but by men who had to be hired for that specific purpose and not as part of a military obligation as militia. Sometimes even hiring men especially would not work. In 1778, the Massachusetts government sent down to the town of Booth Bay, or Townsend, as it was then called, sent down to the town of Booth Bay some cannon to protect the town and authorization to hire 50 men in state pay to garrison the fort and to man the guns. The Booth Bay authorities, the town fathers, were unable even to hire a garrison. And the town leaders complained that the new armaments were, again I quote, a proper bait by which our enemies have been induced to pay a degree of attention to this place which it is probable might otherwise have been directed to ports of greater importance. End quote. See their problem. With all these guns and ammunition, suddenly Booth Bay takes on an importance which the Booth Bay residents feel is unwarranted, and the enemy would go and sack other towns rather than Booth Bay, but with all these guns, Booth Bay must be important, and so it simply serves as a magnet to draw the enemy to their town. What's their solution? They can't hire. They got these guns, got these ammunition. The solution, the town leaders carried the cannon and the powder and shot deep into the interior, and there buried them. Henceforth, insignificance would be Booth Bay's chief line of defense, not the militia. And I would add that Booth Bay was not the only town that had that sort of a problem and had that sort of solution. Is that the presence of a number of Native Americans, apparently, I emphasize apparently, on the American side, was the most serious deterrent facing the British. But it did not mean that the Indians had formally allied with the Americans. Actually, the Indians were quite careful to avoid permanent commitments to either the Americans or the British, although they flirted with both sides. The Indians were heavily dependent on white society for provisions, for food, for their hunting was badly disrupted by settlement and by the war. So for food, utensils, clothing, guns, and ammunition. And as the Americans and British competed vigorously for Indian allegiance to one side or the other, the Indians skillfully played off one side against the other to their own advantage.
For work on, you got a little place to set a rock or something to pound on, pounding rivets, whatever.
Now, who were making these? Early settlers, Indians? Roughly what time period?
I'm not really sure what the time period was on them. I think the history of them is they came over from Africa. They were like an African chief's chair. And the chief would have something that was similar to this, only bigger and fancier. And of course, when the blacks came over, they were all equal among themselves.
That's a carrying basket for most.
They could have
most anything.
You know, they all made their own chair like this. I think it was taken from that.
All sorts of different clubs.
Nick, who would have used the board chairs? I don't know that they're in.
You want me to really tell you?
Yeah.
Yes.
It's
on the TV wants to know.
They're African in origin, actually.
Okay. Yeah. So you were right.
And whether or not they were really used that much in colonial times is really up in the air.
So you think they came over in slave ships? I mean,
well, you see, they were surely, I'm sure they were known. So, but it's not the type of thing that survives well.
Yeah.
So unless there's a known, nobody will say, yes, they had them. Unless somebody can show you one, an original, or a painting of that time period with one in it. And there aren't any right at this moment.
Okay, so we're not going to see these in antique shops or anything?
No.
Okay.
No. Well, if you do, then somebody's fine.
Somebody made it 10 years ago, and it's
Look underneath. Might have my initials on it.
Wood doesn't traditionally last 200 years.
Right. Right.
But it's, they're just, they're knockabout chairs, so they would, it's like little head backwards. It's camp gear, it's stuff that, if it breaks, they're going to split it up, throw it in the wood pile.
Right.
So that's why nothing survives. Really commonly used things don't tend to survive.
These guys are so interesting.
If you're going off, if you're going to have a winter camp or something like that, camp for the winter, put them out in the valley or something, you'd probably hack one out. If you're going over the mountain come springtime, you don't want to lug it over there. You just hack it up and make yourself a new one when you get over the top of the mountain.
Very good.
No. Okay, blocks are open, throw.
I'm going to have a nice chair because I'm in town and they got to impress me.
Exactly. Oh, yeah, you're not going to see it in your townhouse.
You know, I did see one of these just recently. It was ornately carved with African designs. And it was on a TV show from England. And it happened to be in the background. And I'm sitting there looking at this thing, ducking around the TV going,
What are you doing?
And do all these hatches and tomahawks save this, serve the same purpose?
Yeah.
The shapes, I mean, is they're...
A lot of them reflect different things.
And now, are they made for cutting or throwing?
Yep.
They were all...
Multi-purpose?
The
toy part just comes because that's just a normal thing that happens.
Right.
You know, I talk to people that worked in the woods all their lives, you know, now in the modern times, and they'll say, yeah, when we were bored, you know, we had little hatchets, little camp hatches and stuff, and we, you know, we spent hours in the woods sitting there throwing a little hatchet because we had nothing else to do. And that's basically what's...
Hey, what are you doing to my hawk?
Why don't you get a sharper hawk?
Race.
Oh, no wonder. He's probably digging rocks.
At least I keep track of my hawk. But these type of...
These type of hawks, the rapt-eye hawks, were a real common trade item because they were beat out real quick.
Yeah.
They used to make these by the barrel in Spain, you know, and sell them really cheap. And some of them had steel bits welded into them, and some of them didn't. They were designed. And
do we have to cut that hair?
Yeah. And these were an earlier style. I mean, these were relatively early, but these were more of a general purpose tool, and you wouldn't necessarily see a hawk exactly that style in the hands of an Indian in the early time because number one, it'd be more expensive because this is all done out of one piece of steel.
Okay.
The eye is actually cut and formed, so it would be more expensive to make. But it's a lightweight hawk, and in later, like Revolutionary War times and past that, this is the type of hawk that a rifleman or a long hunter would carry because it was small and light and it was used to cut up game. It wasn't used for anything else. When they were selling hawks to Indians, I mean, they were looking at them to also bury in somebody's head. And even the frontiersmen, they carried a longer hawk. I have a hawk on my, hanging in my, and they had a long handle because they used it as a defensive weapon.
And who was they? The French or the Indians?
The French and the Indians. And the British colonials and anybody else that happened to be out in the woods for any length of time. They used longer handled hawks because they were effective weapons. Keep that much farther away. You know, it's like if you had a choice between coming up onto a guy with a knife, a little tiny hawk like that, or a big long hawk like this, I'm going to take big long hawk. And that's why when we say that it was more fun in games to throw them, it was more fun in games because if you're sitting there in a battle, you know, and somebody's doing something and you're going to throw your hawk, now you got a nothing, you know.
Right.
So, you know, you didn't. You know, it's too unpredictable of a weapon, you know. You throw it and tree branch or anything could happen, and the best you can hope for is it's going to hit them.
Exactly.
You know, and public.
Okay.
To come in, we have a visitor's day, and we try to... At the one I'm holding in the Northeast, we're going to try to set it up with people that are cooking food that you would actually cook from the time period. And
like the rabbits and the birds,
yeah,
and stuff,
right,
like
exactly,
that.
Exactly.
Fish, obviously.
Making lead balls and starting fires and leather work and clothing and blacksmithing. Nick's a fair blacksmith. But just get giving people ideas of some of the stuff that they did years ago. A lot of it was, it seems simple, but it worked. It wasn't complicated. Yeah, I know it. I know it. What's
that? Common ground fan. It's some weekend or something.
But this is char cloth, which is cooked cotton. It's cotton that you cut up into little pieces, throw it in this tin, put the lid on, throw it in a campfire. And when all the gases and smoke stop coming out of the hole, it's cooked. And it reduces it basically to a layer of carbon on top. And it's hot enough to catch a spark.
That's what I mean.
And this is a piece of high carbon steel, and this is actually a gun flint out of my musket. And the little sparks that come off of it are actually shavings that the stone shaves a piece of steel off enough friction to turn it molten. And you catch it in this little piece of cloth right here. Like I said, you catch it in the cloth. That's lit. There's a couple little red glowing spot there. And that's lit, and that'll burn the whole thing. Stuff it in what we call a bird's nest.
Which is, what's a bird's nest? What is that material?
Oh, it's tow, flax, oakum. You can use pine needles, you can use grass, you can use whatever whatever you want.
Something and fine and very...
Just add oxygen to it.
Cedar bark works good.
Oh, here you go.
There it is.
Okay, now how long has this fire starting to neek? I mean, are we talking caveman?
No, because these bow and drill or hand drill or...
Right.
And several different other types of stuff.
This here is punk sugar maple. It's the sugar maple tree that you can reach right inside and grab the dry wood out of. And you cook it the same way as you do the char cloth, and it reduces it to that. And it also catches a spark.
Watch with mama. Watch with mama.
It's kind of hard to see, but that piece is lit right there. You can also take this stuff.
No.
Put it in a piece.
Just like that. Wow.
And that lights it. And then if you're in a situation where you got wet wood or you want to get going, this is a fungus on a white birch tree, and you can char it the same way. And when it gets lit, it lasts for quite some time.
Sam.
And that's lit. And this little chunk will burn for probably... Yeah. That'll probably burn for, that's a little chunk, probably 5 to 10 minutes.
Really?
That the little white spot in it's actually lit. And if you blow on it, it'll... It'll turn red. So you can put a couple of these together and pile them up and blow on them, and it'll start wet wood going.
Wow. Excellent.
Oh.
I've been working on a history of the Mount Zirkin Spring for about 30 years, and that hopefully will be published this fall, if any luck. And I discovered in the process of doing all of the research on the spring and on the bottle lunch stand that Dexter Abbott, who founded Mount Zirkin, was the first cousin to Hiram Ricker, who founded Poland Spring. And so there are a lot of parallels and a lot of events like the construction of the first bottling plant and the construction of hotels on Mount Zirkin that are very similar to what went on in Poland Spring in the 1860s and 70s. And they originally bottled water at the source right across the road from the Moontide Spring. They started doing that in barrels, of course, in the 1850s, eventually built a bottling plant in the 1890s, and they started putting it in small glass bottles made out of flint glass. And then in the early 1920s, the Mount Zirkin beverages, by that time spring water and ginger champagne and flavored drinks, had become so popular that a group of men from Rhode Island decided to come in, and they made an offer and they purchased the company, and they built a very large bottling plant in South Rumford on the Androscoggin River. And that was opened in 1922. And along with the construction of the new bottling plant, which was very spacious and had room for much more machinery, they could produce a lot more of the Mount Zirkin beverages. Along with the bottling plant, they spent a tremendous amount of money on an advertising campaign. And as part of that campaign, they created an automobile, which apparently stayed in the Boston area. That's where their main office was for a good many years. And it had the name of their most popular drink, ginger champagne, on the side. And you can see it has the Mount Zirkin cap with the famous logo with the mountain and the moon rising in the background. Of course, the Moontide Spring supposedly changes its flow at the different phases of the moon. And
now, that's relatively famous, right?
Right.
That's a,
oh, sure.
Because yeah, I world, actually have heard
known
of
around
that.
The world, yeah.
Yeah, okay.
And then they built the
And
ball.
Is that the only, is there like one other spring in the world that does
no,
that?
No, I've discovered there are quite a few of them.
Oh, there is,
and
okay.
I also discovered that the Moontide Spring is regulated by precipitation, probably, and not by the flow of the moon.
Ah, the moon sounds a lot better, though, doesn't it?
I think I dug too deeply into it. How are you, Mary?
Isn't it?
That was relative to the rest of the country. I mean, is this one of the earliest bottling plants, or were they popping up long before this?
It's one of the earliest in Maine, and the same thing happened at Poland Spring, because Poland Spring was known for its water for years and years, and Poland Spring really didn't start putting it in their own bottles with labels until the 1880s and the 1890s.
So this was before Poland Spring?
Well, they both started the same.
Okay,
time.
But
they
we
started shipping water out in 59. But they,
okay.
But this Poland Spring, I think, was earlier, actually making their own bottles and shipping it out with their own label.
Okay.
Mount Zirkin wasn't far behind, and when they started bottling in 1896, I think there were only like three or four others in the state, including Poland Spring. So very few bottling water, and then that took off, and it was so popular that they started selling what they called. Aerated water or sparkling water, which is carbonated water, and people used it for stomach disorders. They thought it was a great cure-all. It's just all it is seltzer water. And then a couple years later, they started putting flavorings in, and this ginger champagne was their most popular drink. And that's why they put ginger champagne on the bottle lunch.
Now, is there anything left today that indicative of where the spring was? Is there any buildings over there?
The spring house is still there. This building on the upper left was built in 1890. And
is the bottling plant, the big bottling plant, that's still there too.
Which one's that?
That's this one here.
That's still there?
And that's still there, but it's behind trees now, and it's no longer used. Plus, the sign was recently taken down, cut up with a chainsaw and thrown behind the building.
That's kind of...
Now, who owns that now?
It's owned by Perrier, and Perrier owns Poland Spring, and they also own Mount Zirkin. And Poland Spring used Mount Zirkin water in big tanker trucks for two or three years after they stopped using the bottling plant, and apparently it was too expensive, or they just decided not to ship it that way. But the spring house is still there. It looks like the Bethel Water District.
This is your full-time job, dealing with these wares and
yep.
and doing your enacting.
Yeah. Yep.
Making phony
teaching,
antiques.
Making we all the things we construct and everything. It's all full-time.
To regulate our lectures, and we wouldn't.
They've decided to genericize history to the point where you can't talk about guns, knives, tomahawks. You can't talk about the animals. You can't talk about any of this stuff. So. If you're not going to teach history the proper way, what's the sense of teaching history? Very generic to history. They don't, you know, you don't want to mention that this country was founded on religion, religious freedom, because somebody might take offense. And, you know, all this, it gets to the point where if it's going to be this way, then why are you teaching history at all? History books, yeah, the history books basically start at World War II now. And it's really a shame. They just, you know, a very minor piece here and there about, you know, coming to this country. In one of the groups that we were talking with one of the kids, we asked them about the Civil War as opposed to the Revolutionary War. To them, all the wars were the First World War, period. That was it. Anything before, the Civil War, the World War I, the French and Indian, the Spanish American, the Revolution, those did not exist. That was all just
the
not there.
Photo,
yeah.
This world
which is?
Beadwork.
Beadwork.
In Sioux.
In Sioux. So are these examples of Sioux ware, I guess?
Yeah. Most of my designs are
okay.
Copies of Western Sioux.
And any particular reason for that?
Just that's my area of interest.
Oh, really? Now, what would they use some of these things for?
Just designs.
Just designs?
People used to think that every design had some kind of a, conveyed some kind of a message.
Yeah.
It doesn't necessarily. Some of them do, but not necessarily. It's a lot like some of their songs. Some of their songs are merely vocalization to a tune. Not necessarily meaningful. But
so are the actual, like your leather pouches in here, typical of something a Sioux would make, or just the actual beadwork on them?
The design.
Okay.
The design is similar.
Okay.
The actual method is not. This, because this is loom beading or bead weaving, whereas in most cases, they sewed the beads directly.
With the kitties, yeah. She's our neighbor. Rain, snow, sleet, or hail.
And how long has this group been doing this?
1901 now.
Ladies are aging very well.
Thank you very much. That's the idea.
And obviously, everybody working on their own individual projects?
Sometimes yes. We do, sometimes we work on group projects.
You do? Some of the quilts maybe we've seen around in the area over the few years being auctioned off?
Right.
Is that something
fire
you
do? We do a raffle quilt every year for the garden.
Okay, yeah.
Do we make fire quilts for people who are burned out of their homes?
Yeah.
And we help each other by tying and basting quilts for each other as well.
Now, when you make these quilts for auctions and stuff, what are probably the standard sizes?
Double or queen.
Just for, so if you picture like a queen size comforter or something like that.
Exactly.
And how many labor hours goes into
We don't keep track.
No. You would not, you would stop.
How many Tuesday mornings?
Many.
We don't keep track.
Lots of love and...
Yeah. We have fun though, that's the best part.
Yes.
That's correct.
Oh.
Yeah.
Designs and stuff like that.
I started a year ago.
So you've been doing this for a year?
Yeah.
It's a big learning.
Ginny?
14 years. And Ginny's probably been doing it for 30.
Oh, no.
I thought you started when you were in grammar school.
No. Your quilt is here. Done.
Oh, my.
Now, how do you choose your patterns and designs? See something you like and imitate it?
This one of Mabel's is a Carolina Lily.
A lot of times
this was done in a class to start with.
Okay.
This was a mystery quilt that we got from the
computer. From the internet.
Oh, really?
Yeah. We didn't really know what we were going to make after, so we got all the directions.
Oh, that's awesome.
Mine is for a friend, and she chose the colors.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So that's true what they say. Everything is out there, isn't it?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
No, you really haven't got any control of your ball like you do with life.
And that's, we're talking ball. I mean, we're talking a ball, perfectly spherical ball.
Right.
Yeah.
Go get one that deep.
How old is that gone?
That gone there, I just bought 2 weeks ago.
Yeah, but I mean what?
It was brought in 1776.
Okay.
Wow, that's taught by the British.
Colonial times, yeah. Oh, so that's a British gun?
Yeah. That's what they call the Brown Bess. Yep. Brought in by the British, 1776. And that's the size of the ball.
That's a 3/4-inch ball.
Yeah.
And what are those made out of? Just
lead.
Lead, okay.
Yeah.
So they're obviously made to spread when they hit a flesh.
Oh yeah, you think they have that hit anything, any side, like a bone or anything like that, it's just gonna explode.
Yeah.
Well, that's one of the myths with the Civil War too, with all the amputations. Yeah. The medical procedure wasn't that great, but it was the nature of the wounds. There was, even with modern technology, there was nothing to save.
No.
It's not like a modern steel jacket bullet. It's gonna clip your bone. I mean, that thing hit impact and just exploded. There was nothing left to put back together.
No, that's why a lot, you had so many, people with arms and legs and everything else gone. They never even, the bone would shatter. They had to be amputated.
A lot of times, too, I'm speaking out for the Civil War, because I'm not familiar with that. Hasn't yet, but for the gut shot.
You
see a lot of pictures of the old battlefield afterwards, and men laying on the ground.
Yeah.
It looks like someone had gone through their clothing.
Oh, yeah.
Well, that was the men themselves, because they knew if they got a gut shot, they were going to die.
Oh, yeah.
So when they went down, often you couldn't tell exactly where you got hit, because you just had a wild sensation in your body. And they'd be rifled through their chest and their belly to see if it was a gut shot.
Right.
Yeah. Few did survive a gut shot. There was a period of poisoning, that if they could get through it, and if they didn't hit the right organs, they could survive. Like Chamberlain. Chamberlain got hit in the belly.
Joshua Chamberlain?
Yep.
Yeah.
At Petersburg. And he almost died. I guess it screwed up his pancreas or something. Not enough so they couldn't live, but just enough so he was going to be in discomfort for the rest of his life. And he was in awful discomfort. Right?
But he still lived. I mean,
yes, he did. He was tough.
What, into his century? I mean, he lived.
He died in 1914.
Yeah.
is at Sudbury Candidates?
It was started in 1980. We decided we ought to have a summer heritage festival, and Don Bennett was the president of the society at that time. He was one of the people that, I think he, in fact, came up with the name Sudbury Candidates. We were all trying to think of a name for it, and it seemed to be a good name. And get us back to the early days, and that was seemed to be the thing to do. So we called it that, and we had a number of things which we still have today. Children's Parade, we had an antique show at that time. We had things in various locations. Things have changed. We sometimes had different events, different people coming, different musicians, different performers, that sort of thing. But it's basically the formula taken back to the old days.
Last year was held during the Bible. Now, do you envision it ever being something maybe bigger than beyond the Moses Mason Hall Lawn, or do you kind of like that?
I think it can grow. We're hoping it's going to grow. It's grown every year, and the interest in it has grown every year. So a lot of people look forward to it, and a lot of people come every year, and we get different people every year, too. So it's different enactors
or people visiting?
Oh, different people visiting, different people coming, being part of the mix, too.
Yeah.
So we have both people participating both and people that are coming to visit it. So.
Huh.
People come from all over the country.
Yeah.
So.
Do you have like a guest register? I know you did.
Yes,
like
we do. We keep
you had the speaker, so you do.
We keep one all the time, and it's interesting where people come from. And we also, with the barn open, we keep a register over here to keep see the farming and logging exhibit. And it's interesting where people come from all over the country there, too.
Right. So I'll get a little more difficult here. What do you think that should mean to somebody who lives in Bethel? I mean, as far as heritage and what... I mean, what's unique about, I guess, this town, or anything in particular about our early origins of why people would come here? Obviously, because of the valley and the farming, but I mean, is there anything like that might be carried through to what we celebrate today?
Well, we try to have the hall lecture sort of kicks off the first part of the event, and that usually relates in some way to the 18th century, and so we try to have something relating to the 18th century or the earlier time. So people have some idea from there. We also have try to give people an idea of what some of the old time pastimes were, and
such as the guys with the spears and the
and also the
fur trappers.
The children's games or old sack races.
Yeah, I saw that.
You know,
okay, so those games,
right.
The kids' games,
yeah.
Were from an early.
That's right. And of course, the croquet tournament's another one, and of course we didn't have it this year because of the badminton tournament because it was rained out.
Yeah.
But usually we have badminton. Okay. Of course, the horseshoe pitching even stopped. That's for the first time in time I remember. Usually, the horseshoe pitch is pitched whether it's raining or not. But it was so wet one time they had to stop briefly because they were getting so wet. So.
Now I know from reading Randy's book too that Chapman, big musical influence.
William Rogers Chapman.
Yeah.
Yes.
So then, of course, we had the community band over there playing.
That's right.
And, what was Chapman's era?
Chapman started in the 1890s.
Oh, okay, so he was more
than 100 years ago this year.
Oh, really?
And he finished about the time radio came in the 1920s. That was sort of at the end of the grand performances, which had been so much a part of the Mammoth Festival. So radio came in and sort of ended his era.
Now, during that era, is that like when the Opera House and Odeon Hall were built?
Well, Odeon Hall was built in 1891. I think it was officially dedicated around 1907.
Oh, really?
So it's only about 90 years ago.
Yeah.
So. And the opera house over here was done about 1884. It was used prior to the time of the Hall.
But it was built as an opera house?
Yes.
Not as a concert, but as a...
Well, commercial building. Downstairs was commercial activity. Upstairs was a hall where various things took place, including the opera room. Very typical of that period.
Right. And Chapman was a fairly prominent,
very
prominent. Nationally known figure.
Yes, very prominent.
Of course,
he had all kinds of international contacts.
Yeah.
He brought talent to Maine and to New York and to the Northeast.
Now, did Bethel have any type of community musician, a band, any type of group that
well,
you know
yeah,
that
we
had during
had,
that?
We always had some kind of band, almost continuously, right up through, only the last few years have we not had a band.
Oh, really?
Some, and of course we had also had groups of singers, too. So
yeah.
And the Chapmanator had great group of singers from Bethel.
Yeah,
Bethel,
yeah, I remember that in the book, too. Wow. Where, that's another tricky question because I'll have to put your profit cap on. Where do you see the town in 50 years? Any speculation as
well,
to?
I think it's
as to,
good.
I mean, do you think we'll keep the village despite the enormous growth in the ski area? Do you still think that?
Well, we were lucky once that there's no major route going through, unlike Freeport.
Yeah, exactly.
So we're sort of off the beaten path. People have to want to come here.
Right.
They don't just pass through accidentally. So
right.
Want to come here.
So you're not going to have a strip in town. We're probably going to end up having
I think there's
the Sunday
a
River.
Great consciousness about the historical value of Bethel. And I think from the tourist point of view, it's very important to that's a the interest in the town, the tourist town. And it's the goose that's laying the golden eggs.
And Bethel is a tourist town long before skiing was a sport,
right.
Really, in Maine.
Since the railroad came through Maine, we had inns and other places for people to visit, but nothing like it was when the railroad went through. That made it very easy for people to travel to Bethel.
Right. And what did they originally come here for?
Well, they came to just see the wonderful White Mountains,
yeah.
And the vistas of Bethel,
yeah.
and stay with these farm families and just take in the fresh air and
fishing.
Healthy atmosphere,
yeah.
Getting out of those terrible, hot, slimy, terrible cities, you know, and coming here for the fresh air.
Much like people do today,
right,
really.
Right.
I mean,
escaping the horrors of civilization, sores of civilization, Jefferson.
Yeah.
Because
we see more and more people up here in the weekend, the summertime, than we ever did.
Right.
And there's
right.
still,
right.
as far as people who come up and used to live in the city, there's not
that's
a lot
right.
of things happening
that's
here.
Right.
It's just kind
right.
of to escape the household
right.
hectic stuff. And I guess it's kind of a different way to ask that question. Why is a Heritage Day, do you think, important to the Historical Society, to us, or just to be kind of,
well, I think
to keep those roots, I guess.
Historical Society should celebrate, you know, its role is to celebrate and make heritage, raise heritage consciousness with people, and make them aware of the past, and we do it through many ways, and
yeah.
this is a more public way, but we, you know, through publications and programs and special events, and all those things are ways of raising consciousness, and so this is just one more way of celebrating the past and making sure people realize it's important. And this is why one of the reasons we do it, because it's important to have something, particularly in the summer where people are around. And,
yeah.
part of the, and of course it does give a major focal point for August, whereas Monarch Day is
right.
July.
Right.
So
we would like to see it be bigger. I mean,
and I think it is going to become bigger and bigger all the time.
Yeah, well, I think it should be. It
we don't want
to
become so big that it becomes a zoo.
A big commercial, no.
Yeah,
no,
we'll try to keep it in its scale, but the emphasis will always be on, as I see it, always be on non-profit and heritage-oriented and no tacky exhibits and nothing like that. So we want to try to keep it as, you know, as down-home and real, authentic, all those things. As possible,
and without, you know, fear of blowing your own home. I mean, isn't the Bethel Historical Society one of the probably bigger? I don't know, but I know I've heard that when I visited other museums in other towns and stuff, or any old houses,
yeah.
that your name or the Bethel, you know, oh, you're from Bethel. They have a great historical society. I mean,
yeah.
how?
Yeah.
I mean, any kind of pioneering here, or just big for such a small town?
Well, I think we're quite big. I don't know any other town our size which has such a large historical society. It is somewhat interesting to see that most of our members now live outside of Maine.
Yeah.
Which is, I don't know whether that's a good or bad, but it does tell us something about the interest in the historical society, and they are very important to us because they help support us, and without them we would not be able to do as much as we do. And so we need everybody. We need more members all the time. We never can have enough members. Never have enough endowments. Never have enough.
Oh yes.
Activities. I mean, we never always need more activities, more things going on, more exhibits. I'm really looking forward to the time we get this new building, which is going to allow us to expand and really stretch ourselves. And we need to really do that because. too cramped for too long.
Yeah.
So I'm expecting to see many more things happening, and there'll be one more thing to attract people to Bethel, to see this center for local and regional history, which we're trying to establish over there. So.
Well, there you go. I must admit the tape was a little rougher than I had remembered, but it was a learning experience, and you do have to start somewhere. So we'll be working on the quality, especially the sound and some of the editing, and I hope you enjoyed it, and we'll be looking forward to doing some more, and we're trying to figure out the character generating machine so we don't have to begin and end these tapes with me or somebody else telling you what's going on. So have a nice evening.